that overzealous fan found out. Now as Bear head coach, he shows the same volatile nature. Those sideline displays have made for some good headlines, some uneasy players, and some interesting press conferences.
I threw three interceptions of her first start, and I was still playing. We ended up winning the damn game, but no, that doesn't go anymore, I guess. But
nobody stuck up for McMahon more than me. When other people didn't, I did. That doesn't count for anything, huh?
Just at the end of the game, he just killed my confidence. Towards the end there, we scored a touchdown. I felt a nice catch and wheeling around. I thought I was down. The guy strips the ball out of my arm, and Ditka just yells at me, says, "Get out of bounds." I'm just trying to get out of bounds.
In the heat of the game, in the heat of after the game, you say things, and you really don't mean them, but they're said. And I really make a statement, it's true. Coaches should not talk until Wednesday after a football game.
Chicago, player with railroads and the nation's freight handler. Stormy, husky, brawling, city of the big shoulders. A town just right for Mike Ditka's style of play. But is Ditka's stormy, brawling style of coaching right for today's Chicago Bears?
I don't know if there's a blueprint that says coaches should be this way. Was Madden this way? Was Lombardi this way? Is Landry this way? Is Shula this way? Is Knox? Is Grant? No, everybody's different, and I think the worst thing a coach can do is try to emulate one guy. I have to be myself, and at all times, myself isn't going to be pleasing to everybody.
Mike Ditka demands no more from his team than he gives to the game, everything. And his players are beginning to be affected by that emotion, both bad and good.
I wish there was more emotion in the NFL. He's a very volatile person, and he's not afraid to express his feelings. And as long as Mike Ditka is himself, and all of us understand that, everything is going to be fine.
The way I look at it, football is football. I don't care if you're playing peewee football or you're playing professional football. The game was meant to be emotional. And if you can't play with the emotional, you might as well get out.
Emotions will be very high today as the Bears face the Lions in a game Detroit views as a grudge match. They blame Ditka for ordering this block that injured Lions kicker Eddie Murray 2 weeks ago.
Dorson did not hit him first off. He hardly touched him. Now, if he wants to lay around the field like that, maybe we'll have somebody hit him the next time we play him. I'm sorry that even I told our guy to block him. But, you know, in the game of football, it was a play in the old days that everybody did. They went after kickers, and they went after him for more reasons than I did. I went after him to block him, to make him aware, that's all, not to hurt him. And I'd never do that to any player.
Chicago is still not convinced that Mike Ditka is the emotional leader that will make the Bears winner. So ask Ditka's old boss. A man who knows about winning.
He has the qualities that makes a coach. He's willing to work hard. You know, he's very dedicated to the game, and he's willing to pay the price it takes to be a coach today. And all those things are there. And then all you got to have is a few players to work with. And then when you do that, you usually have success.
Irv, as he came off the field, he was shaking left-handed because he duped that locker with the right. Right?
He broke his hand. Can you believe it?
I'll tell you, though, he's consistent. He played that way, and he's coaching that way.
But believe it or not, though, Brent, the players are really very close, and they like that emotional upsurge.
You think he can turn it around in there?
I think he can. I think he can. Their offense is playing real well this year.
Well, what about that quarterback situation? Who should be in there, Vince or McMahon?
Well, Vince Evans is the man. There's no question about it. He's the guy who moves that club.
Well, I'm going to hear from Utah again. The NFL Today will continue on CBS in just a moment.
Died last night at the age of 88, leaving behind a legacy few people will ever be able to touch. Tim Weigel was the last reporter to interview Papa Bear for television, and Tim joins us now. Tim?
Well, Dick, during the past 20 hours since we first learned of the death of George Halas, we have heard a torrent of tribute to a true titan. It's difficult to avoid being maudlin when talking about a man who might honestly be the most famous Chicagoan in history.
George Halas won more football games than any man in history, more than Amos Alonzo Stagg, more than Bear Bryant, more than Pop Warner. But winning football games was only part of the story of Papa Bear. They didn't call him Papa for nothing. He was not only the founding father of the National Football League, but also the father of an extended family of Chicago Bears. As in any father-child relationship, there was tension and even occasional hostility. But in the end, there was, above all, love.
He's made Gil Sayers what he is today. Everything I have today, all my possessions, are with one man. That's George Halas. They say he's tough. They say he's cheap. But I know better. You know, I played for him. I know what he's done for his coaches, some of his players, and I know what he's done for me.
Every football player who ever played for him became by extension a part of his family. And like you accept members of your family, foibles and all, he accepted football players.
There were, of course, many disappointments for Halas and his extended family of Bears. Many of those setbacks were suffered after Mr. Halas relinquished direct control of the team's on-the-field activities. But modern maladies were dramatically overshadowed by decades of triumph in Mr. Halas's unparalleled career. Great moments such as signing Red Grange in 1925, beating the Redskins 73-0 in 1940 in what is generally considered the best pro football game of all time, and of course cutting the Giants down to size to win Chicago's last pro football championship in 1963. At the time, Mr. Halas was only 68. But perhaps Mr. Halas's greatest achievement of all was staying vigorous and dynamic right up until the last days of his 88-year-old life. Mr. Halas died exactly as he lived, with dignity and spunk.
I always thank the good Lord for the stamina that he gives me. I do that daily. It's too much fun to stay active.
And you keep saying you don't have time because, you just make sure you don't have time.
That's right. Time to think of sad things. Just got to keep that old zip going, that's all.
The funeral for Mr. Halas will be Thursday morning at 11 at St. Ida's Church on North Broadway here in Chicago. And if all the people touched by George Halas during his 88-year-old life show up, it will certainly be the largest, most amazing funeral this town has ever seen.
And later in this newscast, Tim, you'll be back for an entire half hour devoted to the life of George Halas. We'll meet the men who played for Papa Bear, show you the legacy he left behind, and then expose the soft side of a man with true grit. Joan.
In other news tonight,
I think he had inclinations that he was failing, but he would always ask about how you're doing, you know, how is Artie doing, and what's going on in your life, are you happy, and things like that. Wasn't concerned about himself, and I know he was in a lot of pain, but wasn't concerned about himself, just concerned about how the people that he knew were doing.
And he was still watching the Bear games, wasn't he, even
yes.
As sick as he was?
Yes, he was, and I think before he passed, they had to, you know, turn the TV off because he was still get upset. As you know, he can get upset.
Yes, Mr. Halas was excitable just like his hand-picked coach, Mike Ditka. Mike gives us an extra insight into George Halas.
Sure, he was a volatile guy. He was an outgoing guy. He said his piece at all times, but yet he had a great heart. He contributed to people. John, and you know as much as I did how many ex-ball players he helped that nobody will ever know about. You know some loans. As a matter of fact, I think he's torn up a couple of mine and over the years. And, you know, Harlan and Doug and a lot of other people can say the same thing. But that was never publicized. The thing that was always publicized was that he was tight with a buck, and that was kind of wrong.
I'll be back with a closer look at the life of George Halas in just a few minutes. Also tonight at 10:30, Channel 2 will present a one-hour special on Mr. Halas. Mike Ditka and Gail Sayers will be here live for that special. Gentlemen.
Thanks, Johnny.
Halas aides had little time for personal reflection. Halas Lieutenant Rudy Custer, 38 years with the Papa Bear, summed it up the best.
It's one of sorrow, and it's a matter of our facing up to the fact that he's no longer with us. I'm certainly going to miss him because he had a cheerful demeanor when he came in the office, and I think that he had a way with people that made you love him.
This is the chair that was occupied by the Papa Bear, George Stanley Halas. There can be no doubt that in his passing, the coach would have wanted business as usual. General Manager Jerry Benisi, whose elevation to replace Jim Finks was one of the Papa Bear's last moves, gave me these comments. Comments I hope the ball club will take to heart.
Mike and I will meet with them tomorrow, with the players tomorrow morning. We do have a game to play, and we will dedicate the season to George Halas and his memory, and hopefully we'll be able to come away with a winner like Mr. Halas was in life.
Pleasure right now to welcome two good friends, Bear quarterback Vince Evans, Hall of Famer George Conner, who began his career with the Chicago Bears back in 1948, playing 8 stellar years following his graduation from Notre Dame. Talk about the Halas toughness for me, Moose.
Well, he was just a great man. He wanted to win above all things. He put the league over ahead of his team, and he led with manliness. He coached all his coaches. He delegated, but he was great with the pep talk. And if you were falling behind or you didn't understand what you were supposed to do, a word from George Halas got you right off your duff.
Vince, I know you spent a great deal of time with the Papa Bear. I would hope tomorrow that you and your ball club will pay more than just lip service to what Jerry Venezia and Mike Ditka have to say about rededicating this football season to a man who, let's be realistic, is responsible for virtually every check in the National Football League.
Well, absolutely, Chet. I think that it is a real sorrowful time, not only in my life, but for many of the guys who had an opportunity to know Mr. Halas in a more intricate way. And I'm sure that the death of George Halas will hopefully allow a lot of guys to really dig deep and to dedicate this season to him. I'm sure that everyone knows in this city how much he wanted to win, and I hope that we can regroup ourselves and come back and do some great things for the remainder of the season.
Would I be safe in saying that above all else, Vince Evans would recall the kindness, the warmth of George Halas?
I tell you, his benevolence unto me was extremely great. I remember quite vividly when I was in the hospital stricken with that staph infection. Here comes this old man with a cane through the door, and it was none other than George Halas, and that really lifted my spirits tremendously. And he sustained an ongoing relationship with my mother as well, who sent many inspirational notes to him, and he corresponded back to her. And he was just a great man.
Moose, I don't know about you, but just one more time, how I'd love to see that square jaw and the fedora giving Bill Downs hell on the sidelines of Wrigley Field.
Well, he, people saw him on the sidelines, saw a different side of Halas. He was yelling and screaming at the officials. He was yelling at the other players. If a player on the other team yelled back when his career was over with that team, he came to the Bears. Halas wanted to win. He was a showman. Way before his time, before television, he put on a show for the fans and everybody in the stands, but he was a great coach and a great man.
Now, visitation will be tomorrow afternoon at the Barron's Funeral Home up on North Clark Street. Funeral services on Thursday morning at St. Ida's Church. In lieu of flowers, it's the family's request that donations be sent to the Brian Piccolo Research Fund, care of the Sloan Kettering Hospital in New York City. And to this great man, we say farewell, reluctantly and sadly. I first met Mr. Halas in 1955. I was 7 years old. He was already 60 and a bona fide living gridiron legend. We would cross paths and swords in later life, but it's that image seen through the 7-year-old eyes that would always endure. It seems like only yesterday. Standing with my father, meeting Coach Halas outside the Bears' dressing room, I was surprised. He was shorter than I had anticipated, but there was the fedora and the dark glasses, both Halas trademarks. He asked me about my schoolwork. I was struck dumb, but I would become a Bear fan forever. I exulted with the Papa Bear when his Monsters won their last NFL title in 1963. I screamed at him to put in Gale Sayers for a 7th touchdown on the Sunday in 65 against the 49ers. He didn't, and I thought none the less of him. In 1968, when he retired from the sidelines, I wept. Many times in the press box, I agonized with the old warrior as he pounded the rail in anger and frustration. In 1975, I introduced him to my new wife. He said to her, "Don't give up on us now. The best is yet to come." It wasn't, at least not in George Halas's lifetime. Nowadays, there are those who would tell you that the final years diminished the Halas legend. They would have you believe that he was tight-fisted, miserly, too cheap to develop a winner. They say he was mean, held too many grudges. To them, I say bunk. They forget. My gosh, how they forget. Yes, he was from another era, a long time gone, when men fought and died for their country. He belonged to a time when drive and ambition and rugged individualism were in style, and a handshake was for keeps. From the humblest of beginnings in downstate Decatur, he began with virtually nothing but a dream. Nickel by nickel, he put it together, building, babying, and bullying his beloved National Football League. He revolutionized the game in countless ways. From Champaign-Urbana came the galloping ghost, Red Grange, then the Bronc, then the majestic Sid Luckman. They all pass in review. Atkins, George, Harlan Hill, Billy Wade, the incomparable Gale Sayers. But always on the sidelines, there was the Papa Bear, challenging, fighting, directing, and protecting his Bears, a combination of love and fury. No, he was not the man for this age of computers and megabucks. He was not the owner to bedeck himself in gold chains, running an expensive toy merely as a tax write-off. We mourn the passing of George Stanley Halas, But we also mourn the passing of a sports era, of simpler times, without lawyers and lawsuits, without agents, TV ratings, and drug scandals. For most of this 20th century, George Halas fought and won the fight like no one else. He stayed the course. He upheld his beliefs. His likes will never, never pass this way again.
Bill joins us again with more on the Halas legacy. Tim?
Dick, George Halas was born on the west side of Chicago on February the 2nd, 1895. He didn't leave us until 88 years later, when he died at 8:27 last night in his north side apartment. George Halas was a Chicagoan down to the tips of his steel-toed shoes. We were privileged to claim him as one of our own. And George Halas always said that he was privileged to be one of us, particularly after surviving a disaster that nearly cost Mr. Halas his life 68 years ago.
George Halas was 20 years old when the steamship Eastland capsized in the Chicago River, killing 812 people. Young George was supposed to be on that ship and was initially reported among the missing. But at the last minute, he decided not to take the trip. And for the next 68 years, Mr. Halas knew he was a blessed man. And until he died at the age of 88, Mr. Halas bestowed many of those blessings on others.
He was someone that I loved very, very much. He did so much for me when I played with the Bears, and even after I retired, we became very, very close friends.
And there never was a man who you would ever rub shoulders with who left the indelible mark that he left upon the people he had met.
Most people remember George Halas as the hard-bitten, tough-talking coach who chewed out referees and bit nickels in his tight-fisted control of the Bears. But beneath the gruff exterior was a warm and sensitive man who earned the undying loyalty of those who knew him and worked for him. Even those who tangled with Papa Bear never lost respect for him.
I really look forward to negotiating a contract with him. I knew I was never going to win, and I knew I was never going to get what I wanted, but it was interesting. It was a challenge. And that to me is something that you can never, you can't explain that to people today.
The Halas saga was stranger than fiction. Mr. Halas won more football games than any coach in history. He even batted against Walter Johnson and played before Babe Ruth with the Yankees. He also suffered along with Bear fans through many depressing defeats. And he was stung by the criticism of Bear fans and the media, who demanded that he sell the team. But the most bitter loss of all for George Halas was in 1979, when his son Muggs suddenly died, shattering the dream George had of leaving the Bears to his first child.
The toughest was at night. That's where it really hit me the most. That's because I had all my dreams tied up in him.
Yeah. And it jolted you, obviously. Nobody expected it.
That's right.
How did you deal with that grief?
Well, it's tough to begin with, and you don't know. You just carry on from day to day for quite a time till you finally did grab hold of yourself and say that you got to carry on.
Well, not only did George Halas leave indelible marks on the men he coached, his Bears rewrote the record books, filling its pages with memorable lore from numerous title games.
His 326 victories are the mark that the Don Shulas, the Tom Landrys, and the Bud Grants will all have to chase. An incomparable record that might be impossible to break. George Halas and his Monsters of the Midway won 5 world championships, and they stand out as NFL classics. We remember 1940 at Griffith Stadium in Washington. The Bears won the most one-sided NFL title game in history, wiping out the Redskins, a team they had lost to in the regular season, 73-0.
George Marshall, their owner, called us a lot of crybabies, and he said we were a first-half team only and had no real great ability. And, of course, all those quotes appeared in the paper, and I did make certain that they did appear on the clubhouse wall, and we worked on that, and we were really prepared.
And we remembered 1963 at Wrigley Field, the Bears' last world championship. In the bitter cold, the Bears and Giants waged a fierce battle that saw Chicago intercept the great Y.A. Tittle 5 times. And the 14-10 win over the Giants, perhaps the crown jewel of Halas's 5 championships.
Ironically enough, one of the teams that George used to reminisce most about was the 1934 championship team, a team that had gone through the regular season 13-0, Tim, but they lost in the famed sneakers game against the New York Giants 30-13. He calls that team one of his best of all time.
And he would tell Bill Osmanski and Sid Luckman, he used to try and coax his players to go over. Since they were wearing cleats, he wanted them to step on the Giants wearing the sneakers.
That's right.
George always looking for that little edge.
They had a great NFL run.
The NFL, and watched it grow to a $1 billion business and a sport that has grabbed the fascination of the entire country. To put it briefly, his life was well worthwhile. Even in his later years, he was a hard-nosed competitor.
To the end, and no matter how adverse, George Halas enjoyed his role. He was Papa Bear.
George, will you please clarify once and for all for us the senility issue? You feel
Hey, Bill, nuts to you. There's no senility in his goddamn carcass.
Yes, he had a way of winning a point without arguing it. George Halas was tough right from the beginning. Halas was 25 when in 1920 he and partner Dutch Sterneman brought the old Decatur Stalers to Chicago and renamed them the Bears. The franchise cost Halas $50, and he had to hustle for customers until 1925 when the Bears signed Red Grange out of Illinois. The first of Halas's dynasties was born in the early 30s, and in 1932 he bought Sterneman out for $38,000. The Bears are now worth $30 million, but more than that, the team is a monument to the determination of one man.
Long ago, I've adopted Louis Nader's book. He's a well-known attorney and author, and he wrote a book. And in the book was a certain paragraph which stated, nothing is work unless you'd rather be doing something else. And that's what the philosophy that I adopted.
With 326 coaching victories to his credit, Halas had many good teams, but the last dynasty was in the 40s with Sid Luckman, Danny Fortman, George McAfee, and other immortals. There followed a long dry spell, but one more time, a Halas-coached Bears team won a world championship. That was 1963. Today, there are many people reflecting on memorable moments with George Halas, some bitter, some sweet, as befits a man as tough, as determined, and as thrifty, and as generous as he was. But my favorite moment came on the occasion of his 80th birthday when George Halas came to my office.
Well, Mr. Halas, I'd like to thank you for coming on. 80 years, if I ever live to be 80 years, I know I won't look like you do, but I know we haven't always agreed on everything, but I think we agree that things are looking up for the Bears, and I want to wish you the best
of luck. Yeah, I think we agreed on salary all the way, didn't we?
I didn't.
I mean, you always got paid.
I always lost out to you in salaries. I don't want to talk about that.
I'm glad to hear it. I'm glad I got the best of somebody.
George Halas got the best of many people, but for 88 years, Chicago got the best George Halas was able to give.
George Halas spent 65 years of his life in pro football, but there was an interruption in that period when Mr. Halas did his part in World War II serving in the Pacific. In our special tonight at 10:30, you'll see Mr. Halas not as a coach, but as a lieutenant commander in the Navy. Genie has a preview.
Well, he stormed up and down the sidelines like a grizzly gone berserk.
It was enthusiasm to win a ball game. And it was just characteristic of him. He stimulated not only the fans, he stimulated the players.
Above all, he wanted to win, but not at any cost. Rich or poor, in good times or bad, those who knew him well say George Halas always had one thing.
There was a native class about George. You felt when you're in his presence, there was something different about this guy. He could be godlike one moment, and he could be as rough as hell and cuss the hell out of you the next moment. But he wouldn't keep books. He wasn't an even man.
They knew each other for 60 years. When Halas threw out the first ball at Wrigley Field several years ago, Judge Maravitz was beside him. The judge hosted Halas's 88th birthday party this year and appeared in the last known picture of him.
He had class when he was a bum, when he didn't have any money. You couldn't pick up a check with him. When he didn't have it.
But why the reputation for being so tight?
Ball players primarily.
George had a little trouble coming back to the fact that we were getting big TV money, and he had to give some of it away. George liked to hold on to that buck like a lot of us, and he was a businessman.
The older players who had neither agents nor boxcar salaries are kind in their recollections. Running back Hugh Gallerno starred for Halas in the 40s and stood by him during his jousts with newcomers and the news media in the 70s and 80s.
Perhaps to Halas' diplomacy
was intellectual dishonesty. He was tougher than any man I ever met. But he was fairer than any man I ever met.
Arthur Vasey knew nothing about Halas and little about football when he began working on Papa Bear's biography 5 years ago. The retired foreign correspondent is now a convert.
A hero, I think, is a hero at anything. And he's helped so many people. Everywhere you turn, you find people that he's helped, and always very quiet. He never, ever, if he would give money to a charity, he would put a thing that they must not announce it.
Federal judge, friendly competitor, foreign correspondent, closest friend. All paint the same picture today, a view unlike the one many of us held, but a man with an iron will and a heart of gold.
He started to slip about a week ago, but he knew my birthday was on November 1st, which is today. But he had the presence of mind to tell his secretary to give these cufflinks to Mike on his birthday, which is today. And I received them yesterday, the day he died.
Was known to millions of football fans as the Papa Bear. And he was revered and admired as the kindly grandfather of pro football, which he certainly was. But a lot of people have forgotten the fact that for 40 years, George Halas was the coach and driving spirit behind the Rock'em, Sock'em, Bruise'em, Break'em Bears. And when you talk to the men who played against George Halas, you'll find that the Papa Bear wasn't always lovable and cuddly.
I think teams tend to take on the personalities of their coach, especially the good coaches. And Halas was a special case, tough, ornery, and mean in his own right. I think you saw that develop in his Bear teams.
George Halas was an intense competitor. You knew that you were going to get the works from him. He's going to throw the book right at you. And we told him that they were going to be in the most physical football game they'd ever been in their life when we played the Bears. They'll hit you hard, they'll hit you high, they'll hit you low, they'll hit you fair, and they'll hit you unfair if they have to get you.
Chicago Bears, when I came into the league, were noted as the intimidators of the league. Nobody wore face guards in those days or put all these chug pads on and everything. And we got in the old dressing room up there, and I looked around and saw all these guys cutting those Johnson & Johnson tubes and putting chugs here and here and across their shins. I asked the guy next to me, I was just a rookie, and I said, what's everybody getting all this gear on? Son, he said, you're in Wrigley Field. He said, get every pad you can get on and look around for some more, because you're going to need them.
The thing that really annoyed me as a competitor when you went to Wrigley Field was that Halas actually sells seats on our bench to patrons of the Bears, and the rope would be right behind you, and the fans would be standing directly behind you with the obscenities in your ear while you're trying to hear what's going on and play a football game. So it was a terrible place to play.
I think Halas stepped on the field on every play. He was a tyrant up and down the sidelines. He'd run up there and run down, and he wouldn't stay in his box, and he berated the officials, and his vocabulary during the games, you couldn't possibly put it on tape, because he used all the expletives of you know what I'm referring to, bad words and curse words, and people used to come to Wrigley Field just to see Halas, I guess. He'd stomp his hat, but he'd run on the field, and if he got a chance, he'd probably kick a guy.
I saw this overcoated man with his hat run out in the field and literally kick Mac right in the butt. I didn't know who the person was. I just saw, you know, somebody out there doing that. And he tried to get away. And as he was getting away, I was running in that direction. And I took a lunge and a swing at him, and I just missed him. And I found out later, what we found out during the looking at a review of the films, that it was George Halas. If I would have hit him, I'm sure he would have felt it.
As I was trying to get up, I saw these brown shoes jump on my hands. Knowing full well who had these shoes, I came up very slowly with my helmet along this brown vest and butted Mr. Halas gently. And with that, of course, the entire Bear bench jumps up, and George puts his arms like this, and he says, hold it. And he came towards me, and I never moved, and he threw both arms around me like he was punching. I never moved. And he threw him around me like this, and he pulled me in tight, and he said, I always wanted you to play for me. And I've never forgotten it.
If things are going good and everybody's putting out, you can't find a better fellow to play for, and he's good company. He likes to kid around and joke, and he's just a lot of fun to have in the party when things are good. But if things are going good, he can be a tough old bear.
Time, Chicago. Now join the celebration. Super Sunday here on Channel 5.
Live from New Orleans and Chicago, this is a Channel 5 sports presentation. Bears, bound for glory.
Hi, everybody. I'm Mark Giangreco, live in New Orleans. You know, we've been leading the coverage all the way through Super Bowl week, and we'll take you right up to the grand finale tomorrow. Hopefully a Bears victory, we're counting on, and then the big parade back in Chicago on Monday. Tonight, we'll be bouncing around this wild circus of a city. Let's go to Warner Saunders now on Bourbon Street, see what's happening there. Warner?
Well, this is the street called Bourbon, and there they are down there, thousands of Chicagoans, and they all are running Bourbon Street tonight. The bourbon is flowing, and everybody's having a lot of fun. Is this some kind of excitement? Over to you, Rich.
Well, Warner, I'm standing in front of the riverboat Delta Queen on the banks of the Mississippi, and maybe Captain DiMarrero can blow the whistle for us if possible. What a marvelous sound that was, and what a marvelous evening it has been here. About 3 hours ago, some 6,000 Chicagoans crammed into the landing here for an incredible party given by the city of Chicago and hosted by the mayor. We'll be showing you a little bit of that later on in the broadcast. And Ron Majors in Chicago, you would have found it very difficult to believe what went on here.
Good to have, Rich.
It is certainly no less festive a night back here in Chicago. Certainly not shirt sleeve weather by any stretch of the imagination. But Chicago is a hot town tonight as we wait for this kickoff that we've waited 23 years for. We're going to visit some partygoers here in the Chicago area. We'll go out to a place called Riley's Daughter in Oak Lawn to see how they're faring as the kickoff gets closer. We'll also be meeting with the participants in another setting. Now, tomorrow, of course, the players will put the money where their mouths are. Tonight, there were some parting shots. The Bears, you know, are heavily favored to beat the Patriots, so much so that Otis Wilson is saying a shutout could be in order.
So I definitely believe if we come out playing the type of football that we're capable of doing, it can possibly be a shutout.
You know, everyone has their own opinion. You know, so, you know, his opinion is that they're going to shut us out. And, you know, that's great. You know, I'm glad that he has the confidence that in his team that he thinks they're going to shut us out. But, you know, we have a lot of confidence in our team and there's no way in the world they're going to shut us out. And I'll be the first to tell Otis Sunday when we score that, you know, there goes the shutout.
Back live in New Orleans, bound for glory, our 1985-1986 Chicago Bears Super Bowl 20 special. You know, the 1985 season was such a memorable one, full of so many great plays, so many great moments. It's really tough to digest the whole season in one sitting. But we sat down and came up with what we think are the six key plays that really made this campaign the championship one that it was. Now, we put them all together, and we figured out that these six really turned some serious doubts into Big Bear triumphs. The Bears were trailing the Tampa Bay Bucs 28-17 and playing sloppy football when Richard Dent turned the game around early in the second half as he tipped Steve DeBerg's pass into the waiting arms of Leslie Frazier, a 29-yard touchdown that triggered a 38-28 opening day win. In Game 3, the Bears were behind again in Minnesota's noisy Humphrey Dome when an injured Jim McMahon, begging coach Mike Ditka for a chance to play, came off the bench and launched a 73-yard bomb to Willie Gault. The relentless Bears went on to flatten the Vikes 33-24, and the nation, glued to their televisions on this Thursday night, began to take notice. 10 days later, the Bears were trailing the Washington Redskins 10-0 early in the second quarter when that man, Gault, did the job again, taking the Redskin pickoff coast to coast to ignite a 31-point outburst on the way to a 45-10 victory. A landslide was beginning to develop. Game six was an elemental exercise in revenge, as the Bears gained payback for that 23-0 NFC title loss the winter before with a 26-10 victory over the Super Bowl champion 49ers. An old-fashioned ball control drive capped off by Walter Payton's 17-yard touchdown put the Bears in the driver's seat for a conference championship. Week 9 saw round 2 of pro football's longest-running version of the Hatfields and McCoys, as Jim McMahon lobbed this touchdown to emerging American hero William Parrish. The Bears and refrigerator iced the Green Bay Packers 16-10. And Week 10 saw the defense demolish the Cowboys as Dan Hampton tipped Danny White's pass into the hands of Richard Dent to begin doomsday for Dallas, a 44-0 Bear masterpiece en route to a record-tying 15-1 regular season. After 6 weeks of waiting for the playoffs, the Bears were ready for the New York Giants. Coach Mike Ditka had said his team was antsy. They cut loose with overwhelming vengeance. It began when Sean Landennis scuffed this first quarter punt, which was promptly scooped up by Sean Gale for a quick and easy 6 points. As the wind howled and the temperature dropped, the Bears lowered the hammer. Richard Dent led the way with 3.5 sacks as the Bears advanced to the NFC title game with a 21-0 shutout over their ancient rivals from the Big Apple. Next came 45 visitors from the warm coast wearing the colors of the Los Angeles Rams. Jim McMahon took charge immediately, dancing for the first touchdown as the Bears took a 10-0 halftime lead. Then the Bears put the vice on Eric Dickerson, cutting his previous week's production by 202 yards, as Mike Singletary and friends held Eric the Great to just 46 yards on 17 carries. The snowflakes fell like confetti. Some said it was the work of George Halas watching from above. And the Bears capped off another perfect afternoon as Wilbur Marshall ran 52 yards with Dieter Brock's dent-induced fumble to finish a 24-0 ticket to Super Bowl 20 way down yonder in New Orleans.
Approves of it or not, I mean, if it's going to help me to get ready to play Sunday, I'm going to do it.
Tuesday, a change of heart by Bears president Mike McCaskey allowed acupuncture specialist Hiroshi Shiriashi to join the Bears here to continue puncturing the punky QB.
I'm here for him and make make Bears feels better so they can win the Super Bowl.
Wednesday, a local TV helicopter hovered over the Bears' closed practice session and got a windshield full as McMahon decided to moon the chopper.
That's no big deal. I just let them know where it hurt.
Thursday, a New Orleans sportscaster who's since been suspended went on the air with an unconfirmed rumor about McMahon bad-mouthing the local ladies.
Basically, I understand he said most of the ladies he ran into were sluts. He said most of the people he ran into were stupid.
A small but vocal group of women gathered at the Bears Hotel gunning for the punky QB.
It says, man, shuffle your ass back to Chicago.
We've also received a few bomb threats here at the hotel.
I'll be lucky to be alive, I guess, after the day.
Meanwhile, back at WDSU, the station issued a formal retraction, made Deliberto apologize.
I sincerely apologize to Jim McMahon.
You guys in television, you do that stuff all the time. But you know, you put things on the air that aren't backed up, and it's I think it's ridiculous.
Back at the rally, the ladies were then told it was all a big mistake.
We were a little premature then.
All right.
Yeah, we apologize.
I don't like his attitude.
Friday, Commissioner Pete Rozelle hit town, joked about the headband affair.
If it gets big, I'd want to take advantage of it personally.
And then tried to put the whole McMahon mystique into perspective.
I think that Jim has been a fascinating folk hero, an individualist whose personality has captivated the country in recent weeks. I do, however, feel that he can cross that line. And some of you have already written derogatory comments concerning Jim, which I regret. We're trying to sell him, and I want him sold, not knocked. But I realize that there is a line that is difficult when you cross to avoid criticism.
But McMahon could care less and continues to describe himself as McMurphy, the character played by Jack Nicholson in the movie One Flew Over
really
the Cuckoo's Nest.
That movie. That's one of my favorite movies of all time. I think the character he played, everybody thought he was crazy, and he wasn't crazy, as everybody knew. But and that's how you folks perceive me, and I'm not nuts either.
All right. A strange footnote to that, though. I was talking to Jim McMahon's agent, Steve Zucker, and he's pulling his hair out over the fact that Jim has been offered a million-dollar movie contract after the Super Bowl. He said, I'm not really interested. I think I'll play in the Pro Bowl, then I want to play golf for a while. The great thing about the Bears being in Super Bowl 20 is the fact that they bring with them such rich history. 20 Chicago Bears are enshrined in the Pro Football Hall of Fame in Canton, Ohio, the most of any team, and it's a roster that virtually mirrors the development of the sport. Just look at this list. Owner, coach, National Football League founder, Papa Bear George Halas, who spans every era of league history. Center George Trafton and original Decatur Staley, who stayed with Halas for the first 13 years of the club's existence. Tackle Ed Healy. Patty Driscoll, a lifelong friend of Halas, who coached the Bears to a Western Division title in 1956 when the Papa Bear took a two-year leave from coaching. Red Grange, the galloping ghost of Illinois, the man who gave pro football instant credibility when he joined the Bears in 1925. In the 30s, the tradition was carried by tackle Link Lyman and Bill Hewitt of Michigan, who refused to wear a helmet while playing, and fullback Bronco Nagurski, the dominant player of the decade. As the 30s came to an end, the Bears came into their greatest years. Tackle Jumbo Joe Stidahar, guards George Musso and Danny Fortman, and 13-year center Bulldog Turner. They cleared the way for halfback George One Play McAfee and supplied the pass protection for quarterback Sid Luckman. Those Bears won four world titles and another division crown. There were no titles in the 50s, but the Bears always challenged with such men as quarterback and place kicker George Blanda, who played with the Bears for 10 of his NFL record 26 years. His roommate and outstanding tackle linebacker George Moose Connor, and the game's first middle linebacker, Bill George.
We're back up in the woods among the evergreens.
I think they have probably more tradition than any club in the National Football League, and the Bears have always been a close-knit group, not only when we were playing, but still when we get together today. And that Bear spirit is there because of George S. Halas.
Absolutely. Ron, it's like a hurricane here. I'm telling you, it's really whipping up. Half our set blew down, but I have to tell you that most of those players, who of course are still living, are down here as guests of the NFL, and they've been partying all week with us as well.
You know, part of the other tradition and history of this season, Mark, is that previous game the Bears played against the Patriots. That's the one the Bears won 20-7. The second game of the season that came in September in the heat of Soldier Field. Well, the Patriots say they are a different team now, but the Bears say they are, too.
They say they're a different team, they're a different team.
You've got to be living in a fool's paradise if you don't think they're going to show up here playing their best football.
But you're a legend in your own time, a hero.
These guys came in fitting capstone to his brilliant career. It puts him up on top of the mountain now as he looks down on every other player who's ever played in the National Football League.
Walter Payton's saga began at Jackson State, where he scored an NCAA record 464 points, a mark that still stands. Payton scored 65 touchdowns and ran for better than 3,500 yards. But Walter Payton already had made his first television appearance. It came in 1971 when a 17-year-old sweetness stole the show on Soul Train. With his feet back on the ground, Walter went on to become the first man chosen by Jim Finks in his initial draft in 1975. He has vindicated that competence many times over. Payton became All-Pro for the first time in 1976 as he gained 1,390 yards. But greater days were to follow. It was unseasonably warm and rainy on November 20th, 1977, and Walter Payton was fighting off a 101-degree fever and the flu as the Bears went to battle the Minnesota Vikings. Walter shrugged off that illness with a mighty vengeance, though. He carried the ball 40 times for 275 yards, the single most productive game in league history. And the Bears beat the Vikes 10-7 to earn a wild card trip to the playoffs, their first since 1963. Payton continued on through the 70s and into the 80s as the Bears marked time in the lower third of the pack. But the coming of Mike Ditka as head coach in 1982 signaled a new day for Walter and his Bear teammates.
Walter Payton is one of the great athletes who's ever come into the game. Now, to say that he would be any greater, I don't know if that's possible. I hope that we can utilize some of Walter's strengths in other areas.
On October 7th, 1984, Walter Payton replaced Jim Brown as the National Football League's all-time ground gainer on this six-yard run against the New Orleans Saints. Payton went on to lead the Bears to the NFC title game at San Francisco, a 23-0 loss that left the Bears determined to gain revenge and a Super Bowl title this time around. Payton was as smooth as crushed velvet in 1985, as he did indeed lead the Bears to the Super Bowl with a record 9 straight 100-plus yard games. Finally, on Sunday, January 12th, the Bears turned around and won one for sweetness as they shut out the Rams 24-0 to guarantee that long-awaited overdue trip to the Super Bowl.
Sure, most of the players want to win this Super Bowl for themselves, but if they don't, they won't be able to look Walter Payton straight in the eye. Ron?
I think I agree with that one, Mark.
Well, we've been watching all the hype from New Orleans. You have to wonder now and then, is the Super Bowl a matter of life or death? We'll check out this answer.
We got to win this game. I've had too many low points in football. I don't think I could stand another one. I'd just kill myself. Up one who lives.
But let's take a look at tomorrow's schedule here on Channel 5 and NBC. It'll be a busy one. At noon, Notre Dame visits top-ranked North Carolina in a top basketball matchup. Then there's the Super Bowl pregame show beginning at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. The blank non-commercial minute will take place shortly after 3. We'll have more on that later. Game show begins at 4 with a kickoff between the Bears and the Patriots, actually at 4:15. Then post-game presentations and interviews run until about 8 o'clock. And NBC then presents a movie, The Last Precinct, from 8 until 9:30. Albert Hitchcock Presents will take us up to 10 o'clock, and at 10 o'clock, we'll have a special edition of Channel 5 News wrapping up the biggest day in Chicago sports history with all the celebrations and all the other Super Bowl moments. Now, for that blank minute that comes on the television screen tomorrow, it will come at 3:02 in the afternoon. No commercials, no talking. But according to producer Francine Whitaker, it won't be a total blank either.
You will see something on screen. There will be visuals, there will be animation, there will be music. So it's not, in its beginning stages, it was considered a black moment. Now we've embellished it a little bit.
Because over at our local station, we got experts that go into black, so I didn't know why we need to pay you all that money for it.
I'm not getting paid a lot of money.
So remember, the bathroom break comes at 3:02 in the afternoon. That's an important time to remember, Mark.
I'll be ready, Ron. I'll be ready. You know, we showed you earlier what Jim McMahon's been doing down here all week. Let us draw an historic comparison for you now. Of course, the fridge has been the league's media hit of the decade, but Jim McMahon, the bad boy of the 80s, is indeed a superstar now. And he has really captivated the imagination of Super Bowl fans and other players around the league. You know, a lot like a guy who played quarterback for the New York Jets back in 1969.
I did it my way. Oh, what is a man?
He was about the brashest punk anybody ever did see, that Joe Willie Namath. The Colts were anywhere from 20 to 40 point favorites to beat the Jets in Super Bowl III. And here's Namath, the guy who brags about his babes and his booze, saying he personally guarantees a Jet victory. The nerve! Brashest punk anybody here's ever seen, that Jim McMahon. Here's a guy who hates to practice, loves his beer, and calls his own plays, and wins. The nerve. Namath defied Commissioner Pete Rozelle over ownership of Bachelor's 3, a New York bar. He finally backed down when he was threatened with permanent suspension. McMahon defied Commissioner Pete Rozelle over a headband endorsement, mocking Rozelle in the NFC title game, and making it an even bigger issue on NBC's David Letterman show. He hasn't backed down yet. Namath and his Jets beat Baltimore 16-7 in Super Bowl III, proving that old Dizzy Dean adage, if you can do it, it ain't bragging. He did it his own way, all the way, to the Pro Football Hall of Fame. Will McMahon succeed by doing it his own way? Well, thus far, he's proven to be a winner and has taken the Bears to the verge of a world title. Unlike Namath, though, McMahon doesn't brag. He just goes out and does it.
I don't know. I think Joe Namath pales.
Everybody down there wants to be Mr. Mustafa tonight. They all got their Grigory bags, and we are going to win it. Are we not, Ron?
I've got to go along with you on this one, Warner. I've got to. We got a spell on him. You're right. It comes down to the essentials now. Are they ready to play, or aren't they?
I just think it's going to be tooth and nail Sunday, and there's no way in the world that we can look back at the first time we played them.